Hi, everyone. Thank you very much for including me in the program today. I am sorry I'm traveling, and hence I could not be there with you in person, but I definitely look forward to the next opportunity to be able to do so. I was asked to talk about spinal column neoplasms. This is sort of my area of expertise, so I'll be delighted to share my thoughts and our experience over the years in treating these tumors. So, if you look at our overall experience in treating spinal column tumors, over the years, over the last 26 years, we have accumulated quite a bit of an experience. As you can see, we have treated over 5,000 spine tumors. Majority of them were metastatic tumors, as that would be the case for anyone who is dealing with these tumors on a regular basis. And as you can see, we have used a variety of approaches in treating these patients. The cancer field has evolved significantly over the last several decades. Originally, as you might remember, the tumors were described based on their organ of origin. Lately, they are classified based on their genomic profiles. As you can see here on this slide, where we have three different tumors from three different organs, endometrium, ovary, and breast, despite the fact that they come from three different sites, their genomic profiles are similar, and hence they actually are also treated in a similar fashion. This is just one example of what we call now precision medicine, where melanomas have been identified. Almost 50% of those carry this particular BRAF V600E mutation. And if you were to use a targeted therapy, targeting the specific gene alterations, you can see you can take a patient like this on the left side with diffuse skeletal and other organ metastases and convert it into a patient like this on the right side with significant regression of the disease. This is just using one single drug and targeting one single mutation. More recently, the checkpoint inhibitors have really become a common stay for a lot of the neoplastic conditions for treatment. And as you can see here, for metastatic non-small cell adenocarcinoma of the lung, non-small cell tumors, you can see if we were to use a combination of PD-1 inhibitors, the checkpoint inhibitors, compared to control, there is really significant improvement of overall survival. And so these patients are now really reaching almost 2 years, 50% of the time, which was really unheard of originally when I was in practice at MD Anderson Cancer Center many years ago. I would like to give a case example here to make some of the clinical points. This is a 50-year-old female who is otherwise healthy, does not really have any history of cancer elsewhere. She presents with 3 months history of thoracic pain. There is mild weakness in the lower extremity and some gait impairments, so thoracic myelopathy picture. This is the patient's MRI scan showing a single set of abnormality in the vertebral body, suggests will be spinal metastasis. But this patient does not have a known primary, and we don't already know what this represents. I put this slide here, and I'm just making the argument here that if you were to do a biopsy on this patient, and I put that put down here for the hypothetical diagnoses. The first one is a lymphoma, the second is breast cancer, the third is renal cell carcinoma. The fourth one, as you can see, a chordoma or primary tumor as a result of the CT-guided biopsy. And so I would make the argument that if you were to get the lymphoma diagnosis, that patient most likely is going to go to the medical oncology and will be started on multimodality chemotherapy. If the patient gets breast cancer diagnosis, most likely the radiation oncologist would offer conventional radiation treatment. If we end up getting a renal cell cancer diagnosis, we will think about a surgical procedure to at least separate the tumor from the spinal cord and follow that with sweeptectic radiosurgery. And then finally, if we end up getting the diagnosis of a chordoma, a primary spinal column tumor in a single site, we would consider removing this tumor in one piece with negative margins. So as you can see from this slide, the initial diagnosis of the patient really charts the treatment. It's a very important step in the management of these patients. So we try to establish a diagnosis whenever we can, although this may not be possible under some emergency circumstances. If you look at our sort of previous experience, just looking at the primary site in patients with metastatic spinal column tumors, you can see overall survival rates here ranging anywhere from 4 months, which is dismal and typically associated with lung cancer or melanoma metastases, to all the way up to over 5 years for a variety of other more indolent types of tumors. This really has changed significantly, as I've shown earlier, both with lung cancer and with melanoma, since the original series were published many years ago, with the new treatments targeting the genetic mutations or using PD-1 inhibitors, taking advantage of the immunotherapy. And the renal cell carcinoma also has really benefited from those sort of evolutions in cancer treatment. However, the primary tumor site still gives you a great deal of information about the chemo and radiation sensitivity of the tumors. Lymphoma, myeloma, multiple small cell carcinoma of the lung are typically highly radiation sensitive tumors, whereas the tumors on the right side of this column, as you can see, are much less responsive to radiation. And hence, the more targeted, the more focused high dose radiation treatment modalities really made a big difference in this category. We also do know that initial biopsy can give you a lot of information regarding the vascularity of the tumor. This is a list of highly vascular metastatic tumors, and renal cell carcinoma is sort of the prototype here, but there are other types of primary sites that could be associated with significant bleeding, such as thyroid cancer, follicular variant, hepatocellular CA, and so forth. Those tumors that are highlighted here in yellow, melanoma, myeloma, they also tend to be very vascular, but they are typically hard to embolize, whereas the other tumors, we always try to embolize the tumor prior to taking the patient to the OR. As you can see on this slide, we have a whole host of treatment options here, ranging anywhere from conventional radiation therapy, minimum invasive surgical procedures, stereotactic radiosurgery, vertebroplastic kyphoplasty, lit procedure, laser interstitial thermal therapy, and even more extensive surgical procedures. And I think that what we are trying to get out of this lecture, how it is that we make this decision in terms of which treatment is most appropriate for a given patient. In making that decision, we use this NOMS algorithm. And you can see there are four variables here, the neurological status of the patient. This particular framework also includes oncological site, essentially primary tumor type, whether or not the spine is stable, the mechanical stability of the spine, and then the systemic extent of the disease, and whether or not the patient is going to be able to endure sort of a major surgical procedure, for example. More recently, as I've shown earlier, genomic profiling of the tumor or the molecular expression of the tumor are all important things that we look at. Degree of epidural spinal cord compression can be measured using this SOSG grade of epidural compression. That's Mark Bilski's work from Sloan Kettering. And the tumors are shown here in various shapes and forms in terms of the degree of epidural spinal cord compression. The take-home message here is that if you're dealing with a solid tumor and the tumor is making contact with the spinal cord, if you were to use stereotactic radiosurgery, for example, for radiation, you have to think about strategies to get the tumor off the spinal cord so that you can optimize the results of the treatment. The stability of the spine, which is another important component of the NOMS, framework can be measured by using the SINS instability neoplastic scale. as you can see here on the, this is the work of originally the Spinal Oncology Study Group. I had the pleasure of leading that group. And when we came up with this, you can see there are major categories here, location of the tumor, the type of pain the patient's experiencing, the, what happens to the bone in terms of the destruction of it or not, the spine is collapsed or there's misalignment, and also whether or not the posterior elements are involved. And based on that, you get a score if you're in the mobile part of the spine, if the patient is having severe mechanical pain, the lesion is destructive, there's already deformity, vertebral body is collapsing, and all posterior elements are involved, the score gets bigger and bigger. And of course, you accumulate these scores, as you can see on the right side, you go from the stable category to the most stable, almost unstable category. We'll look at some examples of that in just a moment. As I said, the treatment of spinal tumors, particularly metastatic tumors, have evolved significantly. For epidural spinal cord compression, the conventional radiation therapy has been the mainstay of treatment for many, many years. And this is sort of the cumulative data from the literature showing what happens when you use conventional radiation therapy. Overall improvement rate, as you can see here, on average is about a quarter of the patients will get better. And obviously many of them would not and will continue to deteriorate. Later, I think the surgeons thought that if you could go ahead and decompress the spinal cord and then couple that with the radiation therapy or alone, you can get better results. No surprise in retrospect that this really didn't make a difference. You got exactly the same results. Not only that, you introduced just the morbidity of the laminectomy procedure, showing that really that didn't really work and didn't add much to the conventional radiation therapy. Later, I think that the surgeons wised up and realized that the laminectomy is not the best way to get the tumor off the spinal cord when the tumor is mostly in the vertebral body and also destabilizes the spine. And if, so you were to do a better decompression and stabilize the spine at the same time, the results potentially could be better. And exactly this is what we saw here, almost doubling of the overall improvement in neurological outcome. And then finally, we have gotten much more comfortable with anterior approaches to the spinal column with vertebral body resection or reconstruction. And you can see results were even better. So if you look at over the last 30 years, this progressive experience in treating patients with metastatic spinal epidural cord compression, you can come to the conclusion that the laminectomy is not the operation you should be doing in the setting of metastatic spine tumors. The better the decompression is, the better the neurological outcome is, and spinal stabilization is an integral part of any type of surgical procedure. Of course, all of this data is based on the conventional radiation therapy as being the main form of radiation treatment. And, but not until this study that was later published in Lancet that the value of the surgery has been clearly established. This was a prospective randomized trial comparing the conventional radiation therapy to surgical decompression stabilization with radiation therapy. And as you can see in this trial, which had to be really stopped in the middle because the midpoint analysis demonstrated the results to be in favor of surgical intervention clearly. And you can see here in all categories, whether or not the maintenance of continence, maintenance of ASIA score, Frankel scores, even the survival times were all better if the patients had surgery plus conventional radiation therapy as opposed to just conventional radiation therapy. So this really clearly established the role of surgery in patients with epidural cord compression in the form of being the main treatment modality for patients with solid tumors. Of note, in this particular trial, all radiation-sensitive tumors, lymphoma, multiple myeloma, small cell, CF of the lung, germinomas, et cetera, all have been really excluded. So we are looking at the majority of the tumor being solid tumors in this study. Of course, as I said, this study was based on use of conventional radiation therapy. That's not until the stereotactic radiosurgery where the field really has changed dramatically. Stereotactic radiosurgery, as shown here with the cumulative experience from multiple sites, that is a highly effective treatment, even in the in tumors that we traditionally call radiation resistant, as far as the response to a conventional radiation therapy is concerned. All of these tumors behave as if they are sensitive to radiation therapy. When you use stereotactic radiosurgery, as you can see, overall improvement rate is quite substantial. both in terms of tumor control rates and as well as the pain improvement, all of those are really excellent. And this has been the case in brain stereotactic surgery as well with a lot of metastatic tumors. This was even true for tumors such as renal cell carcinoma, where we had significant improvement in pain. The tumors were controlled in the majority of the patients, although some of the patients have failed, as you can see here. And it's important to study these patients carefully to avoid these failures. And if you look at this particular paper that came out of MD Anderson Cancer Center, they looked at all the renal cell cancer patients that have been treated using stereotactic surgery. They noted that in this particular trial, about 12 out of 55 patients failed and requiring surgery. And then they noted that if the tumor was making contact with the spinal cord, and if they had administered radiation treatment, stereotactic surgery in that sort of setting, they had to limit the dose to the epidural space in that location, and that really led to recurrences and requiring surgery at a later time. So this really clearly demonstrated that you have to have a better strategy in dealing with these patients. And the answer to this really came from this particular paper by Ilya Laufer, Mark Bilski, and others from Sloan Kettering, showing that one can design a surgical procedure such as so-called separation surgery to separate the tumor from the spinal cord, and then you can follow this with stereotactic surgery. In this trial, they demonstrated that a single fraction of 24 gray really worked the best with very little local progression rate. And this sort of became this mainstay now in treating a lot of patients with metastatic epidural spinal cord compression. And if you have really cord compression seen on imaging studies, one can effectively treat this patient with stereotactic surgery, granted that you can create space between the tumor and the spinal cord. You can take a tumor like this, for example, and convert to a tumor like that on the right side. That would allow you to effectively administer the radiation therapy, avoiding local recurrences. So at least in my mind, this is sort of a simple algorithm that I use in deciding what the patient needs. The first question, these questions need to be asked in this sequence. And this assumes that the stereotactic surgery is a highly effective treatment. But there are situations where we have to operate on the patient no matter what. So the first question we always ask, is the spine stable? If the answer is no, then the patient needs to be stabilized. It doesn't really matter whether or not it's a radiation sensitive or radiation resistant tumor. And that doesn't have to be an open stabilization. It could be percutaneous, it could be vertebroplasty, kyphoplasty, but the patient needs to be stabilized first. And then the second question we ask is whether or not the tumor is sensitive to conventional external beam radiation. And if that answer is yes, the patient then goes and gets that treatment. If the answer is no, then is the tumor making contact with the spinal cord? If the answer is no to the second question, that really means that we are intending now to treat that patient with stereotactic surgery, but we have to make sure that the conditions are favorable for that. And so that we ask the question whether or not the tumor is making contact with the spinal cord. If the answer is yes, then we separate the tumor from the spinal cord, and then the patient goes and gets stereotactic surgery. Let's look at a couple of things here decide how we are going to make that decision for metastatic tumors, and then I also I'm going to change gears here and highlight some of the elements of the primary tumors as well. So this is a general list of the primary tumors. A general list of the primary tumors that we see in the spinal column. These are listed from the most benign to most malignant categories here. And the tumors that are highlighted with capital letters here are highly radiation and chemo-resistant tumors, and those are primarily treated with surgical removal, if possible, with negative margins. And the tumors that are highlighted in yellow are tumors that require multimodality treatment, including chemotherapy, and then surgery plays a significant role for local disease control. And these tumors that have asterisks next to them, those are highly vascular tumors, but also we use repeated embolization as a therapeutic treatment, a therapeutic intervention for those tumors. We looked at our experience working with AOSpine Knowledge Forum on tumors, AOS, Spine Tumor Knowledge Forum. And you can see we were able to extract almost 1,500 patients from multiple databases from multiple sites around the country, treating these tumors on a regular basis. And we extracted 350 chordomas here, roughly, as you can see. When we look at our results, and we have very detailed information in data, in these databases in terms of both recurrence rates as well as survival and the margins of the tumor. And based on that, we were able to show that if you do so-called anything appropriate procedure here, as is shown on the with a solid line here, compared to those who had inappropriate procedure with positive margins, there was a significant difference in survival. And again, the patients who had anything appropriate surgical procedure, they tend to have much less recurrence compared to those who had contaminated margin. And we published this now quite a few years ago in Journal of Neurosurgery Spine, showing that this was clearly the case. Looking at our own experience treating sacral chordomas, the same holds true. As you can see here in this particular series, we tried to treat all of these tumors with the maximal surgical treatment to achieve negative margins, but we failed to do so in some cases, as you've shown, as shown here. So anytime we failed to do so, if the margins were positive, the patients started getting recurrence and dying very quickly, whereas if we were able to achieve that, they tended to do quite well over a long period of time, and clearly showing that achieving negative margins in these tumors is highly, highly critical. Again, sort of looking at both the metastatic tumors and primary tumors in terms of how they differ in the way that we approach them. In the setting of metastatic tumors, our goal is primarily to palliate the patient and to get rid of their pain, protect their neurological function, stabilize them if they have instability. And then the type of surgical procedure that we use in this setting is would be typically an intralesional resection of the tumor. In the setting of primary tumors, however, our goal is really to try to cure the patient, at least get long-term survival if possible. And the surgical technique that we employ, particularly in tumors such as chordoma and chondrosarcoma, would be in a block resection of the tumor. And let's show you some case examples. Before we move on to that, if we look at our own experience, and this is an old slide, you know, quite a few years ago, we extracted our cases, but the point of this slide that the majority of the patients were treated at the time with block resection were chordomas and chondrosarcomas, sarcomas mostly. Here is a case example to make some of these points. This is a patient with metastatic breast cancer showing a destructive lesion involving the upper cervical spine. This patient presents with mechanical instability, severe neck pain to the emergency room. And you can see the MRI scan that looks pretty concerning, but yet this patient is neurologically intact except for severe neck pain, holding her head up in the emergency room. And this patient was treated using modern instrumentation, taking advantage of the occipital cervical construct. This is a construct that we use and treat patients with basal imagination here, as shown. We can take advantage of this instrumentation and then use a distractive force at the cranial cervical junction, as shown here. And then this impact the foramen magnum and pull out the dents, as shown here. And then we can realign the spine by translating the cervical spine forward with respect to the skull base, as shown here. This patient is in a prone position, had a secured and Mayfield head fixator. So we lock these knots here in the cervical spine, loosen these up, and then L shape of the rod allow you to really slide the cervical spine forward, as shown here. And this really can realign the cranial cervical junction effectively. Again, two-step maneuver here. First, distraction across the cranial cervical junction. And second, translating the cervical spine anteriorly. And if you do those things, you can take a patient like this on the left side and convert to a patient like this on the right side. We just did a laminectomy here to be able to monitor the, what we were doing during the surgical procedure. And then subsequently, we didn't really touch the tumor. We just went ahead and treated the tumor with stereotactic surgery, as shown here. Well, let's take another case example. Just a patient, elderly woman, 70s, who presented with metastatic adenocarcinoma of the lung with severe spinal cord compression here, thoracic myelopathy. Here's a CT on the right side. This patient was taken to the OR. Now we're taking advantage of the minimum invasive techniques using two Wilsey approaches on either side. And by doing so, we are able to get to the area of interest, decompress the spinal cord circumferentially. These nerves are tied. And you can see the cage that was inserted through those tubes to reconstruct the anterior column, and then the patient gets percutaneous instrumentation under fluoroscopy. And then that's how it looks like at the end of the operation, the back of the patient. This patient really went on to recover very quickly, neurologically, as well as pain, and got discharged from the hospital 3 or 4 days later. Unfortunately, she died 8 months later with progressive disease, with metastatic disease. But in the meantime, her quality of life was excellent. This is a patient with a large cervical tumor. CT-guided biopsy of this proved to be a chordoma. The story for this patient, obviously, is very, very different than the other patient, where our goal here is to get this tumor out as completely as possible, negative margin. There are surgical challenges here. You can see the tumor extending into the spinal canal, circumferentially involving the vertebral artery on the right side. There's a large pre-cervical component. This was approached in two stages. This is an old slide, so you'll see some old hardware here. First, from posteriorly, occiput is on the right side, the thoracic spine is on the left side. Area of interest is here. We already implanted some thoracic screws here for preparation. At the time, we did not really have the occiput, so we'll call modern instrumentation. We're using wires and other things there. And here is the close-up view of the area of interest. You can see the left vertebral artery that's fully dissected. On the right side, you can see the proximal and distal vertebral artery. Tumor in between the posterior cervical spinal cord, dural sac, C2, C3, C4 nerves that were tied. We stayed out of the tumor here. And then we typically place the stylistic sheet to separate the ventral aspect of the thecal sac from the tumor. And then the second stage of the operation is performed from the front. And this is the instrumentation after the completion of the decompression, mobilization of the arteries with occipitocervical fixation and fusion. And you'll see this is a very extensive instrumentation, but that's exactly what we're going to need at the end of the operation. The second stage is done here with transmandibular circumglossal approach anteriorly. You get this kind of view and view of the critical anatomical structures here. Here's in the operating room on the same patient. Here's the edge of the mandible at the top here. The tumor is visible behind the carotid bifurcation here. This is the internal jugular vein. This is the vagus. We are retracting the tracheoesophagus from right to left here, the tumor mass. The top of the tumor is not really visible here at the moment. So we have to get exposure of that. And this is done by splitting the mandible. As soon as you split the mandible, you can see the whole view is opened up to you. You can see the hypoglossal nerve, and you can see all the important structures. And then we can get all the way up to clivus here if needed. The tumor had been already disconnected from everything else. We cut the vertebral artery on the right side. You can see the stumps of the nerve roots here that have been tied from posteriorly. And this is the contralateral vertebral artery on the contralateral side. And then here's a close-up view of the carotid. The tumor is extracted. And this area is then reconstructed with a cage that was used also as a plate by cutting it a little longer anteriorly, so that the screws can be used to anchor them to the Archer C1 and the C5 vertebral body here. This is really showing the artist's illustration of this construct and the critical structures that have been sacrificed in the process. Here's the tumor mass that had been removed in one piece. Here, how it correlates to the MRI scan. And you can see even this vertebral body containing some abnormality was proven to have tumor. It looks pretty settled on the MRI scan with a T2-weighted image. So we were able to get negative margins on this tumor, and the patient did quite well for a number of years. Here's another tumor that is in the cervical region. This is much more complex in many ways. And you can see, again, the same sort of situation. This patient has a cervical epithelial sarcoma. This extends into the spinal canal, but also goes intradurally, wrapping around the spinal cord. The right vertebral artery, again, is in it. This was, again, planned in two stages, but we were able to remove this tumor in one stage, all from posteriorly here. We started from the back with this hockey stick type of incision, as shown up here. A multilateral laminectomy is open the dura. We were able to separate the tumor from the spinal cord, called cut the C2, C3, and C4 nerve roots on the right side, and then separated the tumor. And then the part of the tumor that was extending intradurally, we were able to unfold it, so to speak, and free up the spinal cord. The key to this operation was really to be able to cut the pedicles on the contralateral side using a bone scalpel here. And you can see we are unfolding the tumor to be able to free up the spinal cord after the laminectomy. Then we are cutting the pedicles on the contralateral side while preserving the vertebral artery. And this allowed us to mobilize a specimen after disconnecting a rostral and caudal ends across the vertebral body of C5 here, which then we were able to separate it from the pharynx and other critical structures, and the whole thing was extracted in one piece. Again, these progressive illustrations are showing the stages of the operation. Here is a tumor mass along with the multiple vertebral bodies have been taken out, and you can see the spinal canal where it used to be, and you can see the part of the tumor that was going intradurally. This shows the cut edge of the dura. The dura had to be reconstructed here, and I'll come back to that in just a moment. This is the part of the cervical spine at the end of the operation on the CAT scan, as you can see here. Then we had to go and reconstruct the dura with three different patches in a circumferential fashion. And then the reconstruction of this area, as we learned from our previous experience, it would be best done by actually reconstituting the lateral masses so that we can rest it against the occipital condyle, which is a really weight-bearing structure here. This can be connected to the posterior construct with false cervical lateral mass screws, so to speak, which are embedded into the case that connects to the posterior construct, which then takes the weight out of the head, transmits through the rods and back into the vertebral body through the pedicle screws lower down. And this shows this in the patient. The right side of the slide is the head of the patient. The left side is the feet. And you can see the area of the dural reconstruction. And here's the lateral mass cage with the screws that are anchored to the posterior construct. You can see the doubling of the rods in the back. This is the patient's postoperative MRI scan showing the large pseudomeningocele anteriorly. But given that we were not in the patient's mouth, this was not an issue. The patient was swallowing and no other problems. And so these post-operative CT scans shows in the scalped image construct and how this looks like on the CAT scan with screws that are going into the cage and how it connects to the posterior construct. All of that really effectively reconstructed for functional use. Another case here, again, a chordoma, it is involving the cervicothoracic junction, and it's going to require a complex exposure. But the point of this slide that we started using now, patient-specific, these 3D printed models. And as you can see here, this allows us to visualize the tumor and its relationship to the critical anatomical structures. And then we can go ahead and use this in the OR to help us guide through the surgical procedure. This is the first stage of that operation that's done using a anterior approach with a trapped up exposure. We have CT guided navigation in the OR. We have intraoperative CT scanners. And here's the stages of the procedure. You can see moving forward, opening up the chest. And then we can do this intraoperative CT. You can actually fuse the patient's MRI preoperatively with the intraoperative CT scan showing exactly where the tumor is located. We, based on that, we can do our osteotomies here in a very precise fashion, sort of just lateral to the tumor to be able to free up the tumor from anterior structures. And then, as you can see here, the tumor is extracted posteriorly, including multiple ribs in a similar fashion that we would do with like a Spears-Hawkes tumor. And then the reconstruction of the posterior region with the cervicothoracic construct here. Here's the specimen that's removed in one piece with negative margins. And here, how it looked like in the OR when we do an intraoperative CT scan. And you can see the ghost of the hardware here showing how this area was really put together after the tumor has been resected. Another case showing a large chordoma involving three levels at the thoracolumbar junction. This shows how we use the MRI scan images and fuse them with the intraoperative CT to be able to sort of map the tumor. This is the MRI. The tumor is mapped on the MRI scan. And then we can do 3D reconstructed images again here, printing of this tumor. And this is how it looks like compared to the original images. This is now the MRI of the patient is fused with the CAT scan. And the tumor is mapped in orange here. And we are using image-guided navigation in the OR that will allow us to stay outside the tumor while we are dissecting around the spinal column. This operation was done in two stages, first posteriorly, then anteriorly. We're now extracting the tumor anteriorly through a combined anterior-posterior approach. Here's a tumor mass, a large mass. Here's a spinal cord. The screws are implanted. The other side already has the rods in place. We are looking through the chest cavity here. Here's a tumor mass, and then we go and extract it, and you can see the spinal cord here. The post-operative construct, again, reconstructed to be able to better visualize on the plastic 3D printed image, printed model, as well as the post-operative CT plain x-rays. This is the last case showing a large tumor involving the lumbar sacral junction. This is again a chordoma. This approached in two stages, first from posterior, then anterior. The posterior approach allowed us to do a multi-level laminectomy, mobilization of the lumbar sacral plexus. That's how it looks like in the OR. Head is on the left side, the feet are on the right side, doubling up the construct, thoracolumbar pelvic fixation, and you can see the thecal sac. You have a number of wires here. These wires wrapping around the hardware is going to be used to secure the cage. And we have another tomato saw here, ventral to the thecal sac, which will be used to cut the spinal column. Here's the second stage of the operation through a midline laparotomy, where we now extracted our wires, and we're going to use that to transect the spinal column. And when it cuts, when we cut through the disc spaces here, we should be able to extract the specimen like this. And that's exactly what happens here. And this is the intraoperative view through the abdomen, showing the construct, either the end plate of S1, the cage anteriorly, and some of the wires that are used to secure the cage. That's much better appreciated on the plain X-ray. You can see how the cage is replacing the missing vertebral bodies and how this area is reconstructed. And here's the patient's specimen of how it correlates to the MRI image. And finally, we have been doing a lot of work on chordomas. As you know, brachyury gene code encodes the brachyury protein is the driver for chordomas. In familial chordomas, the brachyury gene is duplicated in a small minority of the patients. There's a developmental gene that's only expressed during the embryo, and then afterwards shuts off. We have been able to grow the chordomas in an animal model here from one of my patients when I was at Johns Hopkins. As you can see, we demonstrated that if not only can we grow the tumors, and the tumors look exactly like chordoma that seems brachyury positive, but also we can silence it by using a small RNA here. We also have been looking at the molecular drivers of this tumor. As you can see, a number of receptors are overexpressed in chordomas that could be blocked with now commercially available drugs. Majority of them work through the brachyury to drive the tumor growth. Lapatinib, for example, is being commonly used as an EGFR receptor blocker in treating patients with metastatic chordomas. There are also a number of cell cycle inhibitors, CDK inhibitors, that are being tried in chordomas. This is the list of some of the chordoma trials from the NIH website targeting brachyury, EGFR, PDGFR, CDK, and more recently, checkpoint inhibitors are being used for that. And finally, this is our work related to studying the prognosis of chordomas. This is a single nucleotide pleomorphism. Presence of this appears to be protective. Absence of this is really associated with significantly worse overall survival. You can see if you do not have this pleomorphism, all of the patients die within 6 years here in our series. This is looking at the human telomerase versus cryptase promoter mutation in chordomas. That's the work we did with, again, AOSpine Tumor Knowledge Forum. I'm not going to bore with the details, but the bottom line is that the presence of this promoter mutation, again, is associated with better outcome. The absence of that is a signal for poor prognosis. And this is the data from there. You can see the presence of mutation associated with 100% 10-year survival, and the absence of the mutation only gives you 67% survival. So that seems to be a prognostic indicator. So in summary, understanding the biology of these tumors is critical, and defining the appropriate surgical procedure and developing effective targeted therapies and block resection of the primary spinal column tumors leads to improved survival. And clearly, some of the recent advances in surgical approaches, resection techniques, and spinal instrumentation now allow us and other surgeons to remove these tumors completely in with negative tumor margins. A lot of this work was possible over the years through many of the fellows that have come through our program. And you can see them, various fellows that I had the privilege of training, all the way back from MD Anderson years to Johns Hopkins to now more recently at Brown. And many of our trainees are in leadership positions around the country. leading their own programs and focusing on spinal tumors. These are some of the Hopkins residents that I work very closely with, and these are some of my mentors. Dr. Grossman, my chairman, who trained me, Dr. Sawaya, the chair at MD Anderson, I had the pleasure of working with, and Dr. Henry Bram, who was the chair at Johns Hopkins. With that, I want to stop and thank you again for including me in the program, and I am absolutely honored to be a part of this educational activity today. Thank you. With that, I'll stop sharing, and also see if we can stop.